Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you. Wow. I will never, ever let you down, that I can tell you, ever. Amazing. And I want to thank Manchester and New Hampshire, very special. You remember those primaries? That primary came around, and remember what happened during the primary? Trump should come in third or fourth, and we came in easily number one, and that was the beginning. That was an easy one. I want to thank you all. This is incredible. And it's great to be back in a state that I love with thousands of hardworking patriots who are the heart and soul of America, and that's what you are. And we're actually here today to officially launch our campaign to win the great state of New Hampshire in 2020. And I saw some fake polls put out by the fake news media. And it said that I'm tied with three of the other candidates, the Democrats. I'm tied in New Hampshire. I don't think so. I mean, maybe. One of them has a rally. He's got 100 people. So this holds 12,000. We're full. And we could fill it up four times, at least. We could fill it up four times. But I just want to thank you all. I just think it's going to be a tremendous 4 years. We're going to have a tremendous 4 years. Can you believe it? We only have a little more than a year to go, where it all started, right? The greatest movement in the history of our country. The greatest political movement in the history of our country. And even though we had fake witch hunts on our back and all the other things that we had to go through, we have taken this big, beautiful ship, and it's being turned around very quickly. Ago, we campaigned across the country on a pledge to make America great again, and that's exactly what we've done. I think we can honestly say it's the greatest slogan in the history of politics in America, right? Make America great again. So, if you don't mind, you know, the other candidates go, they spend millions and millions of dollars on this question that I'm going to ask you. They spend millions. You remember the first slogan from our opponent? That's right. Neither do I. Neither does anybody. I don't either. Nobody remembers. The only thing I remember is the first night I went out after I heard it. And I said, see, it's all about her. And they immediately changed it after spending like $1 million. They said, it's all about her. That didn't work out too well. That slogan wasn't too good. So we have to do this. We have to make a decision. Do you give up the greatest slogan in the history of politics in our country? Make America great again, right? So do we give up make America great again for a new slogan? Because look, our country is doing great. We are doing very well with China, despite the fact that they want to have you believe to the contrary. All you have to do is say, China, how you doing? They're not too happy. They're not too happy. They're losing millions of jobs. The tariffs are working. And they're eating the tariffs, by the way. There's no price increase. You know, you got to talk to these people. The fake news. But do we give up? And by the way, the biggest beneficiary, you know who have been great? Our great farmers have been so incredible because they've been targeted by China. And frankly, they've been targeted for a long time, including by incompetent politicians that have run this country for a long time. So we're making up for a lot of lost ground. But do we give up, make America great again for keep America great? Keep America great. Okay, you ready? Ready? I love this because it's free. And we have all the time in the world, right? Yeah. Is there anything better than a Trump rally? No. What about a sleepy Joe Biden rally? No. Right? Well, he's made some beauties. I sort of hope it's him. I don't mind any of them. You got Pocahontas is rising. You got Kamala. Kamala is falling. You got Beto. Beto is like gone. But we'll see what happens. Whoever, you know, whoever it is, I don't know that it matters. But whoever it is, different people. But I don't know. I think Sleepy Joe may be able to limp across the finish line. But today they announced that they're going to cut way back on his appearances because he is such a disaster, they're going to have fewer appearances. You've heard that, right? This is serious. They're going to cut way back on his appearances. Can you believe it? If I ever did that, it would be over. The fake news would get us, but we don't let them get us, and it is fake. And today, the deputy editor of the New York Times was demoted. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? All the news that's not fit to print, you know? All the news, the fake, failing New York Times. So, what do I go with? What do we go? You know, it's really we. It's not me. We're doing it together. They came from the hills. They came from the mountains, from the rivers. They came from all over the place. And they showed up, and they voted like nobody's seen before. And it was 306 to 223, remember? 306. And we won Wisconsin. And they said, oh, we never thought of that. Got to think about those things. And we won Michigan. And now we have a lot of car companies coming into Michigan. And we have a lot of great farming events happening really big in Wisconsin. And we have incredible things going on in Pennsylvania. We just opened up a $10 billion plant. We have many of them going up. Many of them. A lot of jobs. Spending in Louisiana, an LNG plant, $10 billion. Could never have happened. Could never have happened. Pennsylvania, it would have never happened. They wouldn't have allowed him to frack. So they would have never been able to build it. But what a place that is. It'll be open in a little more than a year. But I have to make a decision. It's a big decision. Do we give up the greatest theme, phrase, logo, whatever you want to call it, in the history of politics, risky, for a brand new one? Because make America great again, we're really sort of there, and we have a little time left. And now we have a group of socialists or communists, could be. They're not far away. Now the fake news will hit me on that. How dare he say that? But they're not far away, right? They're not far away. 95% tax. Does anybody want to pay 95% tax in the room? I don't think so. So, but I'm not going to go into their plan, because as far as I'm concerned, the Green New Deal is a beautiful thing. No, it's a beautiful thing. We want it to continue onward until about a month before the election. I will let them have it like you've never heard before. I don't want them to change. Too early. It's like Elizabeth Warren. I did the Pocahontas thing. I hit her really hard, and it looked like she was down and out. But that was too long ago. I should have waited, but don't worry. We will revive it. It can be revived. It can be right? It will be revived. And it can be revived very easily and very quickly. And we're going to have some fun in the state of New Hampshire. Now, what do we do? Ready? Let me have first make America great again, then keep America great, right? Just applaud like crazy for the one you want to use for this campaign. And there's a possibility we'll use both. There's a possibility we'll use both. Because I hate like hell. I hate like hell to give up the one. Is there a possibility we'll use both? Maybe one a little bit less. Are you ready? So we'll start Make America Great Again, and then Keep America Great. Okay? Are you ready? Who's in favor of the campaign theme being Make America Great Again? Okay. Who's in favor of our theme being Keep America Great? So, oh, wait a minute, this is your hat. I was going to keep it, actually. Thank you. So, that's really been the reaction. I've done this before, big crowds, and it really is keep America great, because we have these socialists who want to take it away from us. They want to take it away. So it works good. Because until a couple of days ago, and that'll catch up very quickly, we have no choice. By the way, I never said China was going to be easy, but it's not tough, and they want to make a deal. We just spoke to them yesterday. They want to make a deal. They want to make a deal. They have to make a deal. And you know what? It'll be wonderful to make a deal. I don't think we're ready to make a deal. We're taking in billions of dollars in tariffs. And again, China's devaluing their currency. They're pouring out money. The prices haven't gone up, so that means we're taking in billions of dollars. We're not paying for it. And ultimately, their devaluations are going to hurt them very badly. They want to make a deal, and they should want to make a deal. But when you listen to the fake news, look at how many there are. That's unbelievable. I mean, I actually had something today. I had something today. Are we sure that we're in New Hampshire? You know, you have a reputation. I mean, I know it's not true because I know you too well. You have a reputation of being very staid, Very, very elegant state, incredible people. You're not acting it tonight. And that's good. That's a good thing. No, we love our country. We have enthusiasm for our country, right? That's what it is. That's what it is. That's what it is. Before the election, our factories were closing. Hey, who knows it better than you? You're like central casting for the closing of factories. Our jobs were vanishing. Our military was totally depleted. When I took over, our military was sad. We weren't flying half of our planes. They were old. They were tired. Our equipment was tired. Our people weren't tired, though. Our people weren't tired. But everything we had, it was depleted. Now we've rebuilt our military like never before. And all made in the USA, just so you know. And our nation was weakened at home and disrespected abroad. They don't disrespect us anymore, folks. I got NATO to pay an extra $100 billion they weren't paying. They were delinquent. Many nations were, except for seven, many nations weren't paying what they were supposed to be paying. So we're supposed to protect them. They kill us on trade. They have all sorts of barriers and everything else. The taxes are really unfair. The tariffs were ridiculous, what they do to us in Europe. And then we protect them. Then they don't pay. And I say, I'm sorry, folks, you have to pay. You have to pay. They were delinquent. They were delinquent. And my biggest fan is Secretary General Stoltenberg from NATO. He said, until President Trump came along, we were going boom. They would have been finished very quickly. But I'm tired of paying for other nations anyway, I have to be honest with you. Right? And today our nation is stronger than ever before. We're now stronger than ever before. You saw we ended the Iran disaster. How about that? We paid them $150 billion, $1.8 billion in cash. Cash, cash, cash. We got nothing. And they also want to make a deal. China wants to make a deal. And I will tell you, Iran wants to make a deal because the sanctions are not good for them. They are not happy. So we'll see how it all turns out, but it's in good hands. It's in good hands. The United States right now has the hottest economy anywhere in the world. We're rebuilding that awesome might that we were just talking about, our United States Armed Forces. America is working again, America is winning again, and America is respected again, respected like never before. They respect us again, and you see it. You know, a recent poll came out where it showed that President Obama was more popular in Germany and other places than I am. And I said, of course he's more popular. He's not demanding that they pay for their protection that we provide. He's not doing that. I'm doing that. And in fact, if I was the most popular, I'm not doing my job right. Okay? So true. We've created over 6 million new jobs since the election. If I would have said that during the campaign, those people back there would have been headlines, headlines. More than 7 million Americans have been lifted off of food stamps. Since my election, the number of new businesses starting in the great state of New Hampshire has skyrocketed by almost 25%. And you can't really go by my election. You got to go by November 9th, because, you know, the markets have gone through the roof since November 9th. That's the day after I won the election. So I won the election. The markets went up thousands of points. Things started happening. You started doing things that you would have never, even though I didn't get sworn in until January 20th. But they refused to do that. And let me tell you, if for some reason I wouldn't have won the election, these markets would have crashed. And that'll happen even more so in 2020. See, the bottom line is, I know you like me, and this room is a love fest, I know that. But you have no choice but to vote for me, because your 401ks, down the tubes, everything's gonna be down the tubes. So whether you love me or hate me, you gotta vote for me. I had a businessman the other day, one of the most successful guys in the country. I've never liked him, never liked him. He never liked me, I never liked him. I see him in the White House. I said, what are you doing here? He said, I'm working to make sure you get elected. I said, you gotta be kidding. You don't like me, I don't like you. What the hell is this all about? He said, that's right, we've had our differences. I haven't liked you. But to be honest with you, Mr. President, I have no choice. I said, you're right. You're right. First thing I've ever heard him say that I agreed with. He's got no choice. He got no choice. Unemployment in New Hampshire has reached the lowest rate in actually 31 years, but within a very short period of time, it will be the lowest rate in the history of our country. So think of that. You have the best unemployment. You have the most successful state in the history of your state and in the history of our country. And then you're going to vote for somebody else? Oh, great. Let's vote for Elizabeth Pocahontas Warren. We have the best numbers we've ever had. Let's vote for somebody else. I don't think that's going to happen, folks. I don't think that's going to happen. Only with fixed polls does that happen. Unemployment for African Americans, you've heard me say this many times, I'm very proud of it. Hispanic Americans and Asian Americans have all reached their lowest rates ever recorded in the history of our country. Wages are rising quickly. Remember when I used to say people have been working two and three jobs, making less money than they made 21 years ago? I used to say it all the time. Now I can say for the first time in 20 years, wages are rising. And you know who's the biggest beneficiary? Blue-collar workers. My administration is fighting to expand opportunity for citizens of every background and every race, religion, color, and creed. Very important. Because we are all Americans. We all share the same home. We all share the same heart. We all share the same dreams. We are all children of the same Almighty God. But at the very moment when our country should be coming together to enjoy these wonderful blessings, the radical Democrats are trying to tear America apart. They vilify anyone who doesn't share their extreme views. They slander our law enforcement heroes. You see what they're doing with our police that we love. You see what they're doing? Has anyone ever seen anything like the water being thrown on New York's finest? Have you ever seen it? And I know a lot of New York's finest. They're not happy. They're not happy. And they are great people. These are great, great, proud people. For that to be allowed to happen is a disgrace. They view everybody as fascist and Nazis. They used the term Nazi. This was a term you couldn't even use it. Now they use it like on a regular basis, a Nazi. He's a Nazi. Think of that. He's a Nazi. You couldn't use it. Now they use it. They accuse our heroic border agents of running concentration camps. And they do an incredible job. And the Democrats don't want to fix the loopholes or asylum. They do an incredible job, our border agents. And they look down upon the hardworking citizens who truly make our country run. But while the Democrats rage and resist, that guy's got a serious weight problem. Go home, start exercising. Get him out of here, please. Got a bigger problem than I do. Got a bigger problem than all of us. Now he goes home and his mom says, "What the hell have you just done?" We are continuing our incredible movement, the greatest political movement in the history of our country. There's never been a movement like this, never. Our movement is built on love, and it is. And we love our family, we love our faith, we love our flag, and we love our freedom. And that's what it's about. And add to that, the fact that we love our neighbors and we love our country. Together, we are all united by one fundamental principle. A nation's first duty must always be to its own citizens, its own. We've got to take care of our own. You haven't heard that from a politician or a political leader in a long time. It's called America First. It's America First. We're thrilled to be joined tonight by many tremendous Republican leaders and great friends of mine, a man who's doing an incredible job as your governor, because I want to take 100% of the credit for the incredible turnaround of New Hampshire. And I remember it not so long ago. Things were not looking good. People were leaving. A lot of bad things were happening. But we have to give him a lot of credit. He's been a great governor, Chris Sununu, with a great father, too. Great father. With a great father. His father was tough. Chris, your father was so tough. He was for somebody else in the primaries. And then one by one, I won here, I won there, I won there. And then when I won, his father got on and I said, "Oh, this guy kills me. He's so tough." And he said, "President Trump will be the greatest of all time." He said, I said, "What happened? What happened?" He went from being the toughest critic to the best there is. So I want to say hello to your father. Okay, Chris, you'll tell him. Great guy. What a family. What a family. Thank you, Chris. New Hampshire Senate Republican leader, Chuck Morse. Chuck. Thanks, Chuck. New Hampshire House Republican leader, Dick Hinch. Thank you, Dick. Thank you, Dick. Great job. A man who was with me right from the beginning. In fact, he had a meeting at his house. His house has never been the same. His house is a disaster now. In fact, somebody said he just sold it. But you know what? Because of the Trump economy, I'll bet he sold it for a big, big, fat, beautiful profit. Where is Steve? Steve Stepanak and his wife was incredible. Did you make a lot of money on the house? And we destroyed the house. This was the beginning. He held some kind of a meeting for me, and he has a nice house. But literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people showed up, and they destroyed his house. It's never been the same. No wonder you sold it. They finally gave up. And that was 4 years ago. Anyway, thank you very much, both, for being here. Appreciate it. What great people. Thank you, Steve. Great job. And I hope the buyer of his house didn't hear that little... Steve, I hope the buyer didn't hear what I just said about your house. He'll cancel. That's all right. You'll sell it for more to somebody else. Don't worry. Republican Party Chair, Ronna McDaniel. You know, Ronna headed up Michigan. And for many, many years, nobody won Michigan as a Republican. But I used to complain and, you know, just I'd go there and I'd say, they're stealing your car business. I'd go for years. In fact, 5 or 6 years before I even thought about running, for whatever reason, they named me Man of the Year in Michigan. I said, how come? I didn't even understand it myself, but I was named Man of the Year. I wasn't even political. That was years before I did this. But I was always complaining that our car business is being stolen. I mean, it's sort of obvious, right? Mexico now has 32% of our car business. It all left the state of Michigan. We are bringing it back at a level that nobody's ever seen before, our car business. But I went to Michigan, and my opponent was told that the Republicans, no way you can win Michigan or Wisconsin. That you just can't. And we had a campaign manager named Ronna McDaniel. And Ronna wouldn't stop. Sir, can you be here next week? I say, I don't know. Then I leave, and she said, sir, can you come back in 3 days? I said, I don't know. Then I do it, and she said, how about another time? And then on election night, she said, sir, it was 6 o'clock the day before the election. In other words, just a short while before the election, she calls me, sir, can you be here tonight? I said, tonight. And by the way, you know where I was? I was in New Hampshire. That's right. She said, sir, can you be here tonight? I said, are you sure? I started speaking at 1 o'clock in the morning. Now it's election day. We had 32,000 people show up. It was like this. The crowd was just, they want to see things happen in our country. They love our country. It went crazy. And I left and I said, I don't know why we're going to lose Michigan. Why would we lose Michigan? Look at this. And the opponent went there with Barack Obama and Michelle Obama. And she went there much earlier, prime time. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning is not exactly prime time. So we had 32,000, and they had a tiny little crowd. And I looked at my people, and I say, I know we're not supposed to win the great state of Michigan, but I think we're going to win Michigan, and we won Michigan, and we won Wisconsin. We won Wisconsin. Wisconsin was a great victory, and we won Pennsylvania, and we won North Carolina and South Carolina, and we won Florida. And I hate to tell you, We should have won New Hampshire. That was taken away. New Hampshire was taken away. It was taken away from us, but we should have. We did great in New Hampshire. We should have won New Hampshire, but that's okay. I'm not holding it against you because it was not your fault. But we had a woman in Michigan, and I said, when it came time to choosing the head of the Republican National Committee, I said, who the hell is that woman up in Michigan that got me to keep coming there and explaining that we can't continue to lose our car business? We have 17 companies now coming back in. Who is that woman? And it was Rana. We put her in charge of the Republican National Committee. The job that she has done is incredible. Thank you. And the same with another man, our campaign manager. He started off as a computer genius. And remember when they used to say that the Hillary Clinton campaign is highly sophisticated? Highly She did a lot of bad things, folks. 33,000 emails deleted after getting a subpoena from the United States Congress. 33,000. Remember, she said it was about her daughter's wedding and yoga classes. 33,000, yeah. It was disgraceful. I will tell you this, we now have a great Attorney General. A fair guy, a great gentleman. So another man who's here tonight is the world's tallest campaign manager. He is an unbelievable talent. But they were saying about our opponent, I'm not going to mention the name again because I'll never get my, we'll never get it finished here. So I'll just say my opponent. Is that better? And they were saying how sophisticated her campaign was. Except ours was far more sophisticated. And we had a man that did an incredible job. And he's now our campaign manager. And he's one of the tallest human beings I've ever seen. And his name is Brad Parscale, and he is fantastic. It's nice when you don't have to look for anybody. You just look over and you see a guy who's twice as tall as everyone. Great job, Brad.
Thank you.
How are we doing, Brad?
Good.
Doing good. Got great poll numbers. We got great poll numbers in a lot of states, Ohio, Iowa. You know, Iowa, every week that they campaign, our numbers go up. They're winning Iowa. We gave them ethanol, which is very important, a lot of things for Iowa. But every week we seem to be going up in Iowa because they're campaigning in Iowa. Wherever they go, our numbers go up. Somebody's going to have to explain that one to me someday, but we like it. A man who's a friend of mine, who was the greatest mayor in the history of New York City. Stand up, Rudy. Rudy Giuliani. Man, he did a job. He did a job in the first year. I've never seen anything like it. New York was crime infested. We had problems. We had problems like nobody would believe. And Rudy went in there and he did the job. And people loved him for it. It wasn't like, oh, gee, he's a horrible person. People loved Rudy Giuliani. He was a great, great mayor. So thank you, Rudy, for being here. And the first person that I put on the campaign, he was driving me wild. He said, I'm saying you can win, sir. You can win. I'm telling you, you can win. He loves this state. He's from this state. He said, you can win, sir. I'm just telling you. And I had him on for month after month. He'd come drive me crazy. He'd say, you can win. You can win. You can win. And finally, we said, let's give it a shot. And I had Corey. I had Hope. I had just a couple of people. We had a rather lean and mean staff. But Corey Lewandowski loves your state, loves New Hampshire. He was the first one that talked about us possibly winning the whole big ball game. And he's tough, and he's smart. And I'm hearing he's thinking about running for the Senate from New Hampshire. I don't know. I think it'd be tough to beat. I'll tell you one thing. He'll go into Washington, and he's going to have you in mind. He's going to do a job if he does do it. So we'll see what happens. He hasn't made up his mind yet, but he would be fantastic. And I guess it's something you go back and you talk to your family, you talk to your wife, and you make a decision. They're all saying, are you going to support him? I said, I don't know if he's running. So, Corey, let us know, please, if you don't mind. Let us know. Our shared Republican agenda is pro-worker, pro-jobs, pro-family, pro-growth, and 100% pro-American. For decades and decades, the permanent politicians in Washington pursued the very opposite. They sold out our workers. You see it. You know it better than any place. When I talk about the horrors of NAFTA, the horrors of trade deals, I mean, I'm sorry to tell you this. I usually refer to New Hampshire. Nobody took it worse than New England, and nobody took it worse than New Hampshire. Now, here's the good news. I would never let that happen again, and Chris will never let that happen again. Is there a doctor, please? Doctor in the house? Thank you. Doctor in the house. Please, doctor. Please. Thank you very much. Take your time. Yeah, take your time. Take your time, fellas. Plenty of time. You know, people got here 2.5 days ago. Many of these people in the front, right? 2.5 days ago, a lot of these people. So you can understand, it's pretty tough. Thank you. Thank you. That's okay. These are great people. These are great people that love our country. Just remember. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Pretty good. Pretty good. So our politicians shipped away our jobs, shed our sovereignty, surrendered our dignity, and saddled our nation in one foreign debacle after another. And we're still here, he just said. We're still here, you better believe it. And we're here stronger than ever before, we're here. But all of that ended the day that I took the oath of office. The American people are in charge of their country again. We cut a record number of job-killing regulations. They were strangling our country. We cut more regulations in 2.5 years than any other president in their full terms. 4 years, 8 years, or in one case, more than that. Cut more than anybody. To get relief to working families, we passed the largest package of tax cuts and tax reforms in the history of our country. You're making a lot more money. You're making a lot more money, and you see it, and you know it because you see it in your paycheck every week. We ended last administration's cruel war on American energy, and we are delivering a policy of American energy independence like you've never seen before. And in fact, if you look at the straits where we're having all of the problems, you look at the straits, number one, they're not touching our ships. They're not playing with our ships. They're taking them from this country, from that country, from that country. But you know what? Very importantly, we have very few ships going there anymore because we don't need that oil and gas. And the United States is now the number one producer of oil and natural gas anywhere in the world. Every leading Democrat has pledged to abolish the American oil, coal, and natural gas industries that are fueling our economic boom. Can you imagine this? We're sitting on great wealth. They want to take it away from us. And the alternatives don't have the power. They don't have the power. They want wind. Wind. Wind is, oh, so beautiful. As long as you don't have to stare at a windmill and your house goes down in value like to nothing. Steve, if you had a windmill anywhere near your house, you would have gotten one-third the price you got, Steve. That's true, by the way. Steve's too smart to let that happen. We won't let them take it away from you. We are reversing decades of calamitous trade policies that shattered New Hampshire and your factories. They shattered your communities, and they shattered American power and American prestige all around the globe. New Hampshire lost 1 in 4 manufacturing jobs following NAFTA and China's entrance into the World Trade Organization. Two of the worst deals ever in the history of our world, not just our country. Election after election, politicians came to your state pretending to have the courage to stand up for the American worker. Then they went to Washington and let other countries push them around and special interests buy them off and steal your jobs and take your companies. That's what happened. Me, I don't care about their campaign contributions. It doesn't matter to me, folks. We want to do a job. We want to do a great job. And we're setting records. And you know who's sending us the money? The small donors. We have big donors, but we have small donors are sending us the money for the election. Pretty amazing. That's not supposed to happen to a Republican. But it's happening to this republic, and it's happening to you. Every vow that politicians made was broken, every hope was dashed, and every promise turned into a total betrayal of New Hampshire and of our country. But in this administration, we have something those sellout politicians could only dream of. It's called strength and commitment. We don't play games. We don't play games. After years and years of building up other countries, we are finally building up our country, standing up for our jobs, our workers, and standing up for our dignity. The forgotten men and women of America will never, ever be forgotten again. You were forgotten. The last administration with Sleepy Joe and Obama tried to ram through one of the worst trade deals ever negotiated, worse than NAFTA, worse than WTO. It was called the Trans-Pacific Partnership. It would have been a disaster. TPP would have gutted the American auto industry, would have been in shambles. Our auto industry is coming back so strong. Would have gutted, would have destroyed the industry. But in my first week in office, I proudly withdrew the United States from that job-destroying catastrophe. And we're imposing beautiful, well-placed tariffs — money comes in — on foreign countries that cheat our workers, steal our jobs, and break all the rules. I'm sorry. And by the way, they've been changing and charging tariffs on us for years. We have countries that charge us 100%, 200%, 297% in the case of Canada with your farm products. We're not going to stand for it. And man, did we turn things around. And we've just started. If companies don't want to pay a tariff, I have one simple solution. Come make your product in America. Come make your product in New Hampshire. Zero tariffs. Zero. Zero. No tariff. Together, we're restoring this nation's industrial might, and we are doing it with American iron, American aluminum, and American steel. We're doing steel. Steel industry is hot. The steel, they were dumping steel all over. They were destroying our companies. U.S. Steel now, all of them, they're all expanding. The steel industry is back. It's doing great. We're opening up mines in Minnesota, the great state of Minnesota. They have magnificent mines that have the best iron ore in the world, and President Obama closed them down. Maybe we can get Representative Omar from Minnesota to open up, but I don't think so. She'll open them up. I don't think so. Representative Omar, that's another one. We're replacing NAFTA with the brand new USMCA, that's Mexico and Canada. Great deal. The USMCA will create countless jobs for farmers, manufacturers all across the state. We need Congress to pass the USMCA immediately. We'll make it a bipartisan deal. We don't even want credit. The unions benefit. The non-unions benefit. Everybody benefits. It brings it back to fairness, and it makes it very hard for our companies to leave our countries, go to Mexico or Canada, We lose all our jobs, we lose all our taxes, we end up with empty factories and plants. It makes it almost impossible. We're not going to have that. That was my one rule that I had to have. It's going to be very, very hard for companies to do that. I've also taken the toughest ever action to stand up to China's chronic trade abuses. Earlier this month, the U.S. government officially labeled China, for the first time ever, a currency manipulator, another promise kept. While others allowed China to freely loot the U.S. economy, $500 billion a year, not billion, with a B. We've made it clear that the theft of American jobs and American wealth is over. Yet, today, the Wall Street Journal editorial board and some others continue to publish foolish articles that demonstrate that they understand nothing about trade or business, nothing. They advocate only economic surrender. They actually say, go to China, take off the tariffs, make a deal. I lose all the cards we take off the tariffs. We don't have any cards. Think of it. They say, go to Europe. By the way, the European Union is worse than China, just smaller. It treats us horribly. Barriers, tariffs, taxes, and we let them come in. It's worse than China. Many of us come from there. I do. That's what it's got going. That's about it. They treat us really badly. And many others, many, many others. India tariffs us probably higher than any nation anywhere in the world. We have tariffs of 100% on products and much more than that. India. So we're working on all of them. I called Prime Minister Modi. I said, Mr. Prime Minister, not fair. We got to change. We got to change. Got to change. And we're talking to them very seriously. We're talking to a lot of places. But when the Wall Street Journal comes out and they say, no, no, take the tariffs off. Go and talk to China. They've been trying to talk to him for 25 years. But actually, you know what? They really haven't. The fact is, the leaders that were in my position, they didn't do a damn thing. They didn't talk. They didn't talk. Past leaders followed the terrible advice of these editorial boards that are frankly totally inexperienced in business, I guess. And our industries were utterly decimated. Globalism enriches foreign countries at our expense. Globalism. I love our country. I'm the president of the United States of America. I'm not the president of the world. And as long as I'm president, America will never bow to a foreign nation like we were for so many years. As we restore our prosperity, we are also restoring public safety. We are fighting to reduce violent crime. You see so much of it over the last 25 years, so much crime. And ensure that every American can live in safety and peace. And yet, with all that you see, we've had one of the best years of crime prevention that we've ever had. Wouldn't seem that way, but it is one of the best years because those gentlemen that we just saw, law enforcement, they do a great job. And you've been reading about this a lot lately. We are working very hard to make sure we keep guns out of the hands of insane people and those who are mentally sick and shouldn't have guns. But people have to remember, however, that there is a mental illness problem that has to be dealt with. It's not the gun that pulls the trigger. It's the person holding the gun. Years ago, many cities and states, I remember it so well, closed mental institutions for budgetary reasons. They let those people out onto the street. You probably have your examples up here. I can tell you, in New York, they closed so many of them, and they let really seriously mentally ill people out on the streets. And you see plenty of them today, even today. We're going to have to give major consideration to building new facilities for those in need. We have to do it. And at the same time, we will be taking mentally deranged and dangerous people off of the streets, so we won't have to worry so much about that. A big problem. We don't have those institutions anymore, and people can't get proper care. They're seriously ill people, and they're on the streets. We can't make it harder for good, solid, law-abiding citizens to protect themselves. We will always uphold the right to self-defense, and we will always uphold the Second Amendment. We will. So important. One of the most powerful promises I made to the people of this state was to confront the opioid and drug epidemic. I used to go around New Hampshire more than any state, and you'd say, "Sir, the state is infested." You said, "Sir, we're like a drug den. You tell me." And I didn't really see it. And then I met with the police officers and fire departments and all the people that do, and you just seem to have a bigger problem. And by the way, the wall is being built. That's true. That's going to stop a lot of it. The wall's being built. It's being built. You know, we have the fake news, you know about that, where they — a wall that's lying on the ground in a very important section. So we pick up the wall. It's in pieces. I mean, literally, it's gone. And we build a brand-new 30-foot steel and concrete wall. And the fake media said, "He didn't build a wall. That's just renovation." There was no wall. It's lying on the ground. People walk right over it. It's rotted, rusted, gone. We take it away. We put a brand new wall up. They give me no credit. You know why? Because they're fake news. That's why. We're building a lot of wall. The Army Corps of Engineers is doing a great job. They're doing a great job. Since I took office, we've attacked the challenge with everything we have. We have secured a record $6 billion in new funding, opioid. We vastly increased the distribution of overdose-reversing drugs, which are pretty amazing things. We've given them to your police department, your fire department. Pretty amazing. We have reduced the total amount of opioids prescribed by 34%. And the Department of Justice has prosecuted more than 3,000 defendants in opioids-related cases. And our public awareness campaign about the terrible suffering that drugs inflict has already reached 58% of all young Americans. I said that you have to show them. We're doing ads, beautiful ads. Shows them, and you've seen them. I don't even want to describe them. They're brutal. But we're doing ads on television and papers about how bad it is for children so they can see it. Because the greatest thing we can do is not get people started on drugs. Right? Not get them started. It's hard to get off. You know, we can get them off, and we're doing it, and it's been done, but it's hard to get off. If they never start, it's real easy. It's real easy. So we're trying to get young kids. You won't see the fruits of this labor for a little while because it takes a while, but we're really, we are working so hard on advertising and promotions to tell young kids, children, how bad drugs are, how dangerous they are, how horrible they are, how they destroy your brain, how they do so many bad things. And they're really very tough ads. They're hard-hitting ads, and I think they're having a big impact. You'll see. Over time, you'll see. But we still have much work to do. But as a result of these efforts, last year we saw the first nationwide decline in drug overdose deaths in 31 years. It's pretty amazing. And at the center of America's drug crisis is the border crisis. Vast quantities of deadly narcotics are being smuggled across the border, including meth, cocaine, heroin, and fentanyl. And as part of my trade deal with China, it's been very important. And President Xi said he's going to do it. So far, he has not done it. But I said, you have to stop sending us fentanyl. Have to. And you have to criminalize in China the making of fentanyl. And so far, he has not come through, but I think he will. You'll know. You'll know. Yet Democrats want to open borders. And Republicans want strong borders. That's your difference. One wants open borders. Who can even think of an open border? Think of it. Even though many people that come into our country are wonderful people, they're still coming in illegally. They're not coming in through merit. But what about the bad ones? We have serious, serious criminals that want to come in. And if we had open borders, they would be flowing in like you've never seen before. Democrats want open borders. They don't mind crime. We do mind crime. And that's the way it is. Democrats also support deadly sanctuary cities. Last year alone, sanctuary cities declined. More than 17,000 requests from federal authorities to hand over criminal aliens already in their custody. In other words, 17,000 criminal aliens were released by these cities directly into U.S. communities. You don't understand even what the hell are they doing? What are they doing? 17,000. Republicans believe our cities should be sanctuaries for law-abiding Americans, not for criminal aliens. And we will always support the amazing heroes of ICE and Border Patrol, and we will always support law enforcement. Every Democrat candidate also wants to give illegal immigrants free welfare. Republicans believe public benefits should be protected for truly needy Americans, not for illegal aliens, and we should reduce our taxes and many other things with all of that money that we're talking about. We need to elect a strong Republican majority to end sanctuary cities, stop human traffickers, stop drug smugglers, and adopt an immigration system that puts the needs of American workers and families first. It's also time for Democrats to join with us to protect the sacred integrity of our elections by supporting voter ID, voter identification. It's incredible. They're constantly saying, oh, we need to protect our voters. They're not looking for that. They're not looking for that. We say, what about voter ID? In other words, you have a picture, you have to go up. What about voter ID? That they don't want to do. But we need voter ID. The Democrat Party has never been farther outside the mainstream. Where do they come from? You know, you say you want low taxes, good education, strong military, strong borders. You want to have safe homes. You want a house. You want low interest rates. You got low — hey, you got low interest rates, the lowest ever. Got low interest. Good time to refinance your house, by the way. Great time. You got everything. And then you see these people. They're against. They have no idea what they're doing. They have no idea what they're against. Every major Democrat running for president supports a massive government takeover of health care that would raid Medicare and destroy the private health insurance plans of millions of American families that they love. My administration is defending your right to choose the plan and the doctor that is best for you. The individual mandate is gone, the most unpopular part of Obamacare. And we almost have Obamacare gone. We're close. We would have had it before, but we had a vote that was a little bit surprising. I'm sure none of you knew who that vote was. We had it done, repeal and replace. But it's going to happen, and I think it's going to actually be, in the end, actually better. You watch. So we got rid of the individual mandate, which was the most unpopular part of Obamacare. And we're running it better. You know, I had a political decision. Do I make it great? Alex Azar, our secretary. Do we run it well and sort of say, hey, we run it well? Or do we run it badly and have everybody upset? We said we got to run it well, but it's still much too expensive. It's lousy health care. But we got rid of the worst part of it, individual mandate. Individual mandate, where you have the privilege of buying the right not to have to pay for expensive insurance that's no good, health insurance. And we will, and you got to remember this, Republicans, and I speak for every one of them, we will always protect pre-existing conditions. We're going to protect, always. Right? Got to do it. Our ambitious campaign to reduce the price of prescription drugs has produced the largest decline in drug prices in 51 years. And the only decline in 51 years. We have launched a historic initiative to require price transparency, empowering you to choose the lowest price for yourself and for your family. Believe it or not, you didn't have the right to go in and price your drugs. Who could even believe this? I wonder if Big Pharma had something to do with that. So we're going to have transparency. Virtually every top Democrat also now supports late-term abortion, ripping babies straight from the mother's womb, right up until the moment of birth. And in the case of the Virginia governor, he's having a rough, rough time. In his case, the baby is born. And then he goes to talk to the mother. The doctor talks to the mother. The baby is now born, wrapped, as he said. And then they decide whether or not to execute the baby. Who would believe that? That is why I've asked Congress to prohibit extreme late-term abortion, because Republicans believe that every child is a sacred gift of God. Hard to believe, isn't it? Democrats are now the party of high taxes, high crime, open borders, late-term abortion, and socialism. The Republican Party is the party of freedom. We are the party of the American worker, the American family, and the American dream. And I'm fighting for you each and every day. So importantly, we have confirmed more than 140 federal judges. Within 90 days, it will be 179 federal judges. Thank you very much, President Obama. Thank you very much. I don't know what happened to them, but I came to office and I had 138 judges that were not appointed by President Obama. So I say, thank you, Mr. President. Very good. And they'll say, he was a great president. Oh, the fake news. He was a great president. If he was a great president, how come he left me 138 judges to appoint when everybody says that's the single most important thing a president of the United States has to do? Great president. He was great. He was a great president. And these judges will apply the laws written, including we appointed two great Supreme Court justices, Neil Gorsuch and Brett Kavanaugh. And to help patients with life-threatening illnesses, we also passed something I'm so proud of. 44 years they couldn't get it passed. Right to try. You can use our newest, our best medicines. Incredible what's happening. I'm so proud of that. And this from forever, five decades, we passed for our great veterans, VA choice and VA accountability. And one of our great friends, who's a veteran, who's been with me in New Hampshire. I don't know where you are. Where's our guy? Where is he? So, Al. So, I walk in, I said, hello. He's been with me from the beginning. He was there with him. He liked Trump. And I came in, he said, sir, he's a great veteran. He said, sir, I have cancer. And, sir, I went into the vet. They were very, very late. They had problems. I'm not blaming them. But they gave me the right to go out and get a great cancer surgeon. He had his operation. You look much better than you did 3 years ago, Al. Much better. Much better. VA choice, right, Al? VA choice. Great story. Thank you very much. And thank you for your loyalty. You've been — he's been to every rally I ever gave in New Hampshire, right from the beginning. I got so tired of looking at him. He'd always be here. Now he's — look at him. Now he's sitting in — very good. That's good. But I appreciate that story. I appreciate — a VA choice just makes sense, right? Doesn't it make sense? We've achieved record funding for the United States military. $716 billion, $700 billion, and $738 billion, and it's almost completely rebuilt, including, and we hope to God we never have to use it, we have the finest, most powerful nuclear capability anywhere on the face of the earth. And I hope to God, we never have to use it. We're investing in the future of human spaceflight, and someday soon, American astronauts will plant the stars and stripes on the surface of Mars. And I told my guys at NASA, you know, NASA, when we took it over, it was exhausted. The runways and the grounds had all weeds growing through the cracks in the concrete. You wouldn't recognize it now. It's beautiful. It's the best place anywhere on Earth. And I also said, though, you know, I hear all these rich guys, for some reason, they love space. So they're rich. I said, let them send the rockets up. What the hell do we have to do it, right? So I see Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. They're putting rockets up. I think it's great. And they pay us rent. They use our facility. That's good. But we're also doing it. And NASA has some of the greatest plans we've ever had. These are great people, great scientists. But we also let the private sector put up rockets. The one which recently went up, and you see the engines coming back down, and they're coming. There's no wings, no nothing. It's almost like, what are we watching? Is this fiction? And they come down, and they save all of the propellants, all of the really the most expensive parts. They're able to save it by bringing it back right to where it took off. Who would think they could do this? I never saw this before 6 months ago, but they're doing it now more and more. They're saving a lot of the most important and expensive parts of rockets. So we have a lot of rich guys paying us a lot of rent, but we're also doing it ourselves. To protect America's security, I withdrew the United States from the horrible, one-sided Iran nuclear deal. I recognized Israel's true capital and opened the American embassy in Jerusalem. And just 3 months ago, we also recognized the Golan Heights as being a part of and protected by Israel. For years, you watched as your politicians apologized for America. Now you have a president who is standing up for America, and we are standing up for the people of New Hampshire. Thank you. And you must never forget the 2020 election, right around the corner. 2020, right around the corner. And it's about one thing. You know what the one thing is? You. It's about you. It's about your family. It's about your future. And it's about the fate of your country. So when we ran together last time, we said the most important election. We had to turn it around. This country was going bad. You see what happened to Venezuela with socialism. Venezuela, 15 years ago, was one of the richest countries. Now they don't have water, they don't have food, they don't have anything. And this was one of the richest nations in the world. They don't have anything. We're working on it, we're helping people, but it's very sad. It's never going to happen to us because we will never, ever be a socialist nation. Ever. No matter what label they use, a vote for any Democrat in 2020 is a vote for the rise of radical socialism and the destruction of the American dream. We have a dream. It's a great dream. This is the destruction of the American dream. We begin this campaign tonight with the best record, the best results, the best agenda, and the only positive vision for the people of New Hampshire and for the people of America. Together, we will lift millions more citizens from welfare to work, dependence to independence, and poverty to prosperity. Millions and millions of people. With your help, we will elect a Republican Congress to create a safe modern, fair, and lawful system of immigration. We will enact trade deals that are already happening that ensure more products are proudly stamped with that beautiful phrase, made in the USA. We will achieve new breakthroughs in science and medicine, ending the AIDS epidemic in America and finding new cures for childhood cancer. And something I never thought I'd be able to say, within one decade, the AIDS epidemic in the United States will be gone. Think of that. Did you ever think you were going to hear that? No, did you ever think you were going to hear that? The work they've done on AIDS is incredible. It's an incredible thing. When they told me that, it's just shattering. It breaks your heart what's happened. But think of it. In 10 years, the AIDS epidemic will be eradicated. So great. Who thought that was going to be happening? Who thought I'd be able to get to say that so early in what we're doing together? We will defend privacy, free speech, free assembly, religious liberty, and the right to keep and bear arms.